We're moving on, and as already said, we have our opening keynote. And I know, who of you wants to change the world? Raise your hand. Good. That's most of you. But there's actually a few people that actually go on to change the world. And the gentleman who will be on stage in just a couple of seconds has gone on to change the world. It was interesting. While reading up on it, he said, basically there's three things. Things can be useful, they can be entertaining, or useless. I like that a lot. He's gone on to build the most amazing things. I don't want to ramble too much. It's from the topic and the ecosystem of energy and utilities. And before he comes on stage, we'll have a video that'll be doing all of the necessary explaining. In that sense, super excited to have Manoj Bhargava on stage with us in just a couple of seconds. But before that, let's have a look at the video. Thank you.
There are 7 billion of us in the world today. And we're facing some huge problems. Awareness doesn't reduce pollution nor grow food. That takes doing.
I'm Manoj Bhargava, the founder of 5-Hour Energy. I realized we're making a lot of money.
He has cracked the Forbes billionaire list.
If you have wealth, it's a duty to help those who don't.
You know he's trying to save the world, right?
Yeah,
well, that's happening over there.
We're going to the invention shop, also known as Stage 2.
It is the most well-funded playhouse for engineers you can possibly have.
Our goal is to deliver products which can directly impact humanity.
If you come up with something cool that's not useful, we don't do it. I have no interest. I don't want to be cool. I'm never going to be cool. Right now, I'm concentrating in three areas: water, energy, and health.
The drought has left its mark here.
Some communities could soon run out of water entirely.
China, India, Africa. Now, there's a lot of places around the world there's a shortage of water. This is the Rain Project.
We're able to take unusable seawater and turn it into drinking water in a matter of minutes.
This machine can do 1,000 gallons an hour. You create this barge, which has a lot of units on it. Put it a couple miles offshore, pipe the fresh water to land. If you have thousands of barges throughout the world, we can address ridiculous amounts of people.
This is our program we call Free Electric.
The idea here is really simple.
A person uses a hybrid bicycle.
You pedal for an hour, and you have electricity for 24 hours.
Billions of people. This will allow them to have unlimited energy, pollution-free. That's everything.
Stage 2 works on medical devices.
We're working on a project called Renew.
It's a product that enhances circulation.
You squeeze blood from the legs back into the core body, so it acts almost like an auxiliary heart.
Poor circulation is the basis of a lot of illness. It's not about treating disease, it's about preventing disease.
If you don't think through it, you just put up more hospitals. Now, we're also doing that. There's an old story about a blind man heading towards a well, and there's a guy who's watching. If the blind man falls into the well, who gets the blame? If you're watching something that you can prevent, you gotta do something.
We'd like to change the world and make it better. It's a great experience to be with someone that could probably do it.
Manoj is driven by the fact that work is never done.
The world can be changed. It takes a crusader.
My approach is make a difference in other people's lives, not just talk about it. Let's do stuff.
This project is going to drive me crazy.
Are you already crazy enough? What's it to do?
Thank you. I hope you feel the same way after I'm done. Today, the subject that they gave me was, how do you change the world? So, kind of divided into three pieces. One, How do you change the world for the rich? Which is everybody in this room, by the way. Then the second part is, because of this festival, a lot of things that we do are not taught in business school or anywhere else. So as somebody who's done a dozen startups, maybe a different perspective, hopefully things that will destroy what you already know and, you know, make you think that perhaps there's a different way of doing things. And the last piece is how to change the unlucky half of the world. And that's my main focus for my life. That's why I'm doing everything. So the first part that we're doing is changing the world for the rich really only means one thing, and that's in health. Because if you're not doing health, you're making either things that are for convenience or toys for the rich, which I don't think that changes anything. I mean, yes, everything is more convenient, and certainly we have toys that, you know, cars that run fast and so on. Health is the only area where, no matter how rich or poor you are, there's a need. So what we've done is something that's going to be one of the large, we believe in one of the largest businesses in the world in the next 5 years. The way we looked at healthcare and it saw, okay, on the one hand you have patients, and the other side you have payers, insurance companies. And what everybody believes is that what we should look for is more cures for diseases, more treatments for diseases, and that's where healthcare is going to really make a difference. Actually, it's not true at all. The gorilla in the room, the biggest problem in the room, isn't that we don't have enough cures or treatments. The biggest problem is wrong data. In other words, doctors don't know, they don't have the proper data or data in time, and then results in bad diagnosis. That actually is bigger than getting more cures. I'll give you an example. We came up with this, we looked into this area where most of you know what echo is. So you take a picture of your heart, and we found out that if there's an intervention required, doctors are wrong more than 50% of the time. Okay, pretty scary. So it's a flip of the coin whether you're going to get the right treatment or not. And so we worked with one of the top guys in the world in echo and came up with a way. Actually, it's an algorithm that makes it so that you're 95% accurate. And then what we've done is create a data storage and retrieval platform. And on that, what we have is several, what we call sensors. For example, we have a patch that sticks here, and it reads the heart, blood pressure, temperature, hydration, respiration, and oxygen. All in real time, sends it to the cloud, so your doctor can see it whenever. In fact, instead of going to the doctor for that part of the physical, you can do it, put the patch on, and that information is to your doctor, and you never had to go to the doctor. Or you could be sent home from the hospital, and they're still monitoring you. Or they're monitoring you before they, you know, the ambulance picks you up. And some of the stuff that came out of it is amazing. For example, everybody thinks the largest, you know, cause of death is heart. Well, that's not exactly true, because did the heart stop because you died, or you died because the heart stopped? So actually the largest piece is a disease called sepsis. Sepsis is mass infection. And it's so vast that 25% of the intensive care units in hospitals are pretty much dedicated to this one disease called sepsis. Right? What we have is the patch will let the hospital know, before you know any symptoms, that this fellow has got problems coming up. immediately, can you dispatch an ambulance and send him to the hospital? Because what we found out is every hour delay, your chances of surviving it are reduced by 7.5%. So 4 or 5 hours later, there are 12 doctors in the room trying to save each organ. So there are things that are going to change healthcare in a way that nothing else has. So that's an area we're doing. We're also looking for all kinds of other sensors. There are things coming up where we'll be able to tell that you have cancer 5 years ahead of time, and it's just one of the sensors. And the problem with cancer isn't that we need a cure for the tail end, because the problem is you find out 6 months before you're going to drop dead. Well, that's not very good. If you could find out 5-6 years ahead, you could do all kinds of things that would help. So anyway, that's that part of it. The next part of what I want to talk about, because we're in this Pioneers Festival, which is mostly startups, is really about business. You know, to me, business is fairly simple. One of the things that most people hopefully recognize, somebody said, it's not what you don't know that kills you. It's what you think is absolutely true that isn't so. And there are so many things in business that everybody assumes it to be true, and they're completely false. For example, everybody says entrepreneurs are risk takers, right? Well, that's ridiculous. That should be an insult. Because our job as entrepreneurs is to not have risk, is to give it to somebody else, minimize it, get rid of it as quickly as possible, get it out of my shop. That's what the job is. I mean, people say to me, well, you start 5-6 businesses a year. I mean, don't you take risks? No, I don't want to take risks. I try to see how I can not lose money. You know, the first principle of business is don't lose money. There are two principles of business, right? First principle, don't lose money. Second principle, remember the first principle. So basically, that's the first thing. And this isn't just theory. Because if you think about, oh, I'm a risk taker, you're going to do some really dumb things and hurt people. You're going to hurt people that you'll have to fire. So there are lots of things like that are not taken, that we believe to be true that are dangerous. And this is definitely one big one. I think you already mentioned, I always talk about one subject that seems to how we do business, is that when somebody comes to me in my company and says, I've got a project. So my first question always is it useful? And tell me how it's useful. And if it's not useful, it better be entertaining. And if it's not useful or entertaining, there are actually two more categories left. It's either useless or, worse, it's harmful. Actually, I was giving a speech once at a very fancy MBA school, and they called me to give a speech, and I talked to the dean. I said, really? You want me to give a speech? So during that event, I said, yeah, look, what an MBA is, they teach you this much that's useful. Teach you that much that's useful, useless. And about that much that's harmful. And everybody cracked up. And the thing is, it is true. Because you come out of MBA school and you actually think you know something? No. You really start learning anything from your first experience. That's when you really learn something. So I'm going to just take a sort of a list of all the things that are sort of given by everybody. You know, we invest in a lot of businesses. If we invest in a business, the first thing, you know, that people look for is, do you have an exit plan? Anybody that has an exit plan, I don't invest in. Would you lend money to some guy who's got a hat on, 1 foot is out the door, and he says, can you lend me some money, please? No, Those who are the best at business, that's amateur hour, really. I know VCs love all this stuff, but it's nonsense. If you really want to do something, you don't think about how do I get out of it, right? You look at how do I stay in it. So if you don't have that attitude towards what you're doing, why would I give you money? You know, that'd be ridiculous. So anybody, you know, it's one of the things that they say, oh, you must have an exit plan. I think there's some MBA student, a professor that must have come up with that one. No, I mean, I've met a bunch of guys who have made multi-billion dollar, you know, from scratch. And the few things that I found about them were that we seem to be, I mean, I was sort of funny because I looked at them and I thought, oh, okay, there's something similar here. We're all totally opinionated, incredibly confident, don't have any patience, and we like our work, and we're all about the work. We don't chase money, we chase work. What is it that we really want to do? That's the difference between amateurs and not. So, and also there's another word that people use a lot, that's passion, which I also hate. Passion is one of those things, after you get hit in the face a few times, you think, let me go be passionate about something else. What you really need is determination. Determination is an old-fashioned word. What it means is, no matter how many times you fall on your face, you get up and you do it again. And that is the definition of somebody who wants to start a business. If you can't do that, you know, there's an old saying in the United States, they say, if you can't stand the heat, get out of the kitchen. Same thing here. If you cannot tolerate falling on your face a few times, choose a different profession, work for a large corporation. You can get assimilated there, and you really may not have to produce anything forever. Sorry. Wow, it's dry. There's one principle in our company that I came up with. That is the largest cost in business. In my mind, the largest cost in business is aggravation. Okay? Those people who drive you crazy, they don't contribute. They contribute about 2-5%. They take up 80% of your head. Whether it's employees, whether it's vendors, or whether it's customers. What I've found out is that if you get rid of that which causes aggravation, it is undoubtedly the largest cost in business. We all have that somewhere, and most people are too afraid to get rid of, or too lazy to get rid of that aggravation. Whether it's somebody in your company that really, you know, they don't really belong, but, you know, we're just too scared or too lazy to ask them to go where they'll be happier. Or vendors that annoy you and you just keep them on. Or customers, that's the hardest part. What we did was, no matter who it is, whether it's a large customer or not, if you're gonna aggravate us, we're gonna find a better way to do business. And if you look at whether it's your life or business, you'll find that aggravation causes the most problem. And if you don't have aggravation, you have a wonder place to play, you know, that your working environment is awesome, you know, you're happy, the people around you are happy. And that's something that nobody teaches it, but we found out that without aggravation, the number of people required and the number of people that are happy in your business is amazing. We have a company that at retail our sales about $1.25 billion in dollars. And besides the plant, we have 75 people. My competitors have 750, 2,000. I am not sure what they all do, but they have enormous numbers of people. What we do is really simple. What we do is, first, we don't do anything that's useless. You know, we say, okay, you know, is it going to make money? Is it going to make the customer experience better? Is it going to be good for the people that work there? It's going to have some regulatory requirements. If it isn't those four things, we're not doing it. We don't really want to know all this theoretical stuff and get a consultant in and you know, totally mess up the place. So that's another area that we're in. The other thing that we run by, it's just common sense, right? Is, and not experts. The thing with experts is, experts will tell you how things are or how things were. They don't really tell you the future. They're the guardians of the past. If they tell you it can't be done or shouldn't be done, that's a really great thing. Because then you know that nobody else is going to do it. Only you are. Right? So experts have a purpose, which is to kind of tell you what was. But they're not really good at what will be. So one of the things to make sure is you don't get, you know, if you ask an expert about a brand new business that's never been done before, the chances are he's going to say, no, well, it can't be done. Oh, it's dumb. I mean, to me, I usually look at that as validation that I should do it. We've started several businesses where the experts have all said that, you know, I was wrong, I was stupid, I was, you know, every kind of word there is. And yet they were successful. So another area of interest to me is the one thing that schools should teach you, the number one thing in business, and nobody teaches it. And that is a course in human nature, okay? A lot of people, for example, I'll give you examples. A lot of people think that, let's say, General Motors or Mercedes-Benz, you know, they need what I'm selling. They really need it. The issue is, there is no such thing as a Mercedes-Benz or General Motors. There's only a person there who's going to be buying. And he's looking at it and says, why should I buy from this guy? You know, I could lose my job if I change things. So in order to sell anything, you have to understand human nature. And there's an old advertising position that human beings are broken down into basically two emotions, especially in business. And that is, one is greed, the other is fear. So if you're not doing something that addresses either greed or fear or both, the chances of success are pretty tiny. Somebody should say, if I don't buy your stuff, I'm going to be in trouble. Great. Awesome motivation. So whether you're dealing with customers, employees, vendors, somebody above you, somebody that works for you, somebody sideways, human nature is the main thing that you have to look at. There's so many people that come up with products that don't understand human nature and their products fail. Because they're always thinking, you know, those people will need my product. And they never think, what about me? You know, for us, it's a really simple thing. If I'm not going to use the product, if I don't think it's good enough for my family, I'm not selling it. Because there is no them. They are not fools. You know, that's the perception is that, you know, I've come up with some gimmick and named this some fancy name, that they will buy it because they're actually not that smart. No, that's not the way to have a great business. A great business is when you get into it and you say, no, I would use it. And that's our test for anything that we get into. And you know, in this forum, there's a lot of technology, there's a lot of high-tech stuff. And what's not important is whether something is high technology or low technology or no technology. What's the only thing important is it useful? Is it perceived as useful by somebody who's going to buy this? So what happens is people get so enamored of technology that they believe that, look, this is really so cool. Everybody's going to buy it. No, cool doesn't sell. Cool is great for engineers. Engineers love cool stuff. And unfortunately, they make really cool stuff, and then nobody buys it. What, you know, I tend to insult everybody in the room, so I'm trying. But the thing is that if you're going to make something, you need to go in the right direction. One time, I was in the room with one of the top, maybe the top guy in cancer in the world, and he had very fancy degrees, which was kind of annoying to me. So I said, you know, the problem with scientists is they are really good at going down the road, but they're almost always on the wrong road. So he looks at me, starts chuckling, and then he starts laughing out loud. He says, Manoj, you're absolutely right. This is what happens is you first find out what the right road is. What I try to do, since I'm not a really good manager, is I want a product or a service. If I'm even mediocre at, I'm going to be successful. Because if I pick something that's pretty hard, you're going to have to be a really great manager to make it happen. And hope that nothing happens, obstacle comes that's really going to be difficult. So there are things here, these are slight sort of some things to think about. Now, not everybody's going to agree with me, but if you think about it, it really is about common sense. And I said this before, where do we learn common sense from most in our household? It's usually been from our mother, from our mom. Because the hardest part is running a house, because it's 24/7, there's a budget. It's very difficult. If you can manage that, running a business is child's play. The thing is, when she does stuff, everything is by common sense. You get really smart when you don't have much resources and you still have to get everything done. That's what you need. When you have resources, then you're sort of like Silicon Valley, right? What, you know, business is really simple. You buy low and you sell high for a period of time, and that's called a business. Silicon Valley, on the other hand, is you buy high, you sell low, and you make money from investors. I could never understand that. That's why we make fun of Silicon Valley. I live in Detroit, so I'm in the Midwest. And to us, if you're not profitable, you're not a business. You know, if you're just making money, you know, from other people's investment, like Tesla or somebody, you know, just keep giving me money. I'll keep losing it. It's an awesome game. This is one of those things that's relatively new in business, is that you can go on for years just taking money from investors. They, in fact, become your customers. So, but again, in a business sense, that's amateur hour. Right? That's not business. So if you're going to get a business, if you're going to make a business, keep it really simple. Make sure you do buy low and sell high. And you do it in a way, if you do it in a way that it's sustainable for longer periods of time, without that, there is no business. Then you're either the government or you're a nonprofit. and you're, you know, calling yourself a business. And you're going to hurt people, especially the people you take money from. So the other, there's a lot of these things here that are really fashion of the day. You know, one of the things that really hurts people getting things done is enamored of fashion. You don't even know you're following it. You know, for example, if you go to Silicon Valley, everybody there, every third sentence, they have to say ecosystem. You know, if they don't say ecosystem, somehow they don't know what they're doing. These kinds of things, this jargon, it actually stops your brain from functioning. Because you don't have to think about stuff. You can just say ecosystem. Yeah. And there's a lot of it, like risk taker. Oh, I'm a risk taker. No, you really? Please, get away from me. You should go to Las Vegas if you're going to be a risk taker. Please don't go into business. Other things like this are, you know, the most used word in this last couple of years is innovation. Oh my God, you can't get away from it. You turn on any business, anything, and they're talking about innovation. I haven't heard anybody define the damn thing yet, but we have to have it. What is it? And because people didn't define it, they started going down the wrong road. For example, if you're a company, when you are looking for innovation, what you're looking for is not technology. You're actually looking for invention, right? You can't sell technology. A technology is like a laser or a chip or something. Those are technologies. You can't sell those. You can't sell a laser. What you can sell is an invention that uses that technology. So what happened is, lots of large companies thought, innovation, we have to have technology. So they started investing in technology, in developing technology. What they really should have done and what they really wanted was not technology, but invention. Because you can go broke doing technology because there's no buyers for it. So things have to be understood before you go run down the road, right? Now, there's an old saying about a man in a hurry. It says, the man was in such a hurry, he jumped on his horse and rode off in all directions. It's something that you have to think through before you do it. There's so many things within business or outside of business. In healthcare, for example, there's an ad that was running in the United States. It says, stand up to cancer. And I'm thinking, okay, if you stand up to cancer, is really cancer impressed? No. What is it that's gonna accomplish by standing up to cancer? No. Things have to be really thought through. And that's one of the biggest issues, whether it's in business or advertising or life, is that we don't seem to think through what it's doing. So one of the last piece here is that what we did was address, you know, we did, you know, in terms of the business, we did fairly well and made ridiculous amounts of money, which since my wife shops at Walmart, there's not much that we're spending. And so I thought, okay, what do we do with all this stuff, right? And so the only useful thing that you can do with it is to help those who have less, those who really need things. And, you know, the word philanthropy, I'm sure some of you, I mean, most of you know, it's made up of two Greek words, philos and anthropos. And all it is, in actual meaning, it means service to humanity, right? Service to humanity doesn't mean service to rich people. It means the service to those who need it. So what philanthropy is not is giving money to rich universities, putting your name on a building. All of these things, you know, those are nice things, nice hobbies to have. And it's certainly you're giving back to your college. That's awesome. That's great. But it is not philanthropy. You know, in art and museums, and oh, that's great. But who needs this? What's needed is for what I call the unlucky third of the world, right? And I was thinking about it, and I thought, what do you call that part of the world, that 2 billion of or whatever humanity? And you know what people do say, oh, poor people, that's so condescending. The other part, they say, oh, third world, that's even insulting. What they really are is the unlucky half of the world. Because if you actually go down to visit, you will find out they're actually pretty smart. They just don't have any opportunity at all. If you think about it, all of our wealth came from the Industrial Revolution, right? Basically, that means power, electricity. And we left a third of the world out of it. Well, what did you think was going to happen? So what happened is they had no way to get out. And so what we did was something different. Actually, I started off and I did it everything wrong. What we did was, the thought was, well, you know, I don't know anything about philanthropy, I don't know anything about nonprofit. Why don't I find some nonprofits and give them money? You know, sounds reasonable. Found out that most nonprofits, not all, but most nonprofits are terrible. They spend most of their time, if you ever, hear about a nonprofit, the thing they boast most about is how much money they raised, instead of what they actually got done. So we gave millions of dollars out and then found out, oh my God, there was so little really that was getting done. So then we started looking at and going visiting people who actually should be the recipients of this. And what I found out that the answer to the one big question, the question was, what do those who are suffering, those who are without any resources, what do they need? That's the big question. And it was only because of my own arrogance that I couldn't come up with the answer until I went to visit. And then I realized, my God, they need exactly what we do, which is to make a living. That's it. And the funny thing is, nobody looks through it, and what happens? We give them toilets. Here's a guy in a village, he's not making a living, he has no food, but you're going to give him a toilet. You know, there's people that do things like that make no sense. What we did was looked at that, and I thought, okay, we're doing it all wrong. We've got to start from scratch. So we came up with the three fundamentals which define a person's well-being. And on those three, everything else is built. And they were electricity, water, and health. If you have those three, and you're not lazy, you'll be fine. You'll make a living. And this is what we found out. And so I said, okay, look, I don't know why we can't do it. This is one of the problems with an entrepreneur, you know, he thinks he can do anything. So I said, all right, nobody's doing it, I'm going to do it. Which is, you know, if I was under a care of a psychiatrist, they would probably lock me up. But we said, okay, somehow we're going to make it happen. So I put together this group. First, we got engineers, you know, fancy degrees and all. And my biggest problem was, and we had people in making equipment and so on. And there were 30 or 40 of these fellows. And every day I would come in and they would be typing. And I'm thinking, what are you guys typing? Can you not make something? You know. So every day, I just get more annoyed every day. had come in and they're still typing. So I said, okay, this is not working. So I said, you guys got to go. Go type for General Motors. We're out. So what I did was then hire tinkerers, you know, guys who actually build stuff, you know. And one of my guys asked me, I said, what is your criteria for who you're trying to hire? I said, well, they better not have a car in their garage. They better have stuff they're building. And then the whole garage is full of junk they're building, right? If that's that person, that's the guy I want. So we ended up about 30, 40 of these crazy people. Our head guy, Billy, he holds the land speed record in the world. He was the engineer for the car, you know, the salt flats where they go, I don't know how many miles an hour. And somebody who can make that happen, you have to be pretty creative to be that guy. And so what I did was I gave them projects. So I said, first thing I said was, you know, what happened is I was watching NASCAR, which is, you know, you may not know what it is, but it's a racing venue for cars. And there was a guy who had this jack. And he took this jack and put it under the car, and he went like that. And the car almost flipped over. And I thought, my goodness, that's an amazing amount of energy that he just put in there. What if I could turn that into electricity? That's how it started for us. And so we tried handles, you know, the old pumps, water pump type handles. It was a total disaster. Didn't work at all. So we kept working and working, and then we got to a place where we got something. And recently we've put it in villages, and the results have been stunning. I thought there'll be 10 million businesses formed because of this. At this point, it looks like it'll be probably closer to 100 million, and that's just in one country, India. What happened is, when we put it in the villages, then we tried to see, okay, how are people using it, right? So there was one widow with three little kids, and she was busy all day with the kids, just trying to manage the kids. And then what she would do is, after dark, when the kids were asleep, for half the night, she would sew. Because now she had lights, and she would make $5 a day. And $5 a day, where she lived, is enough to make a living. Kids to school, all of it. And it was like, my God, just by having lights. Think about it in your own house. Suppose every day at 6 o'clock, you had nothing. No lights, no TV, nothing. You just sat there in the dark. How productive would you be? That's the fate of billions of people. So what we're doing is have come up with something that we've really thought through what a person needs. What was happening is, in India, right now they're still doing it, unfortunately, is solar. And the problem is they didn't think through what the issues would be. Right? What happened is I talked to the fellows that were actually on the ground working it in the ministry. And one of the guys said he didn't want to tell me the story until he got relaxed. And then he says, you know, we took this whole district and we put solar panels everywhere. And the next week, there was a hailstorm. And everything was destroyed. I mean, he was laughing about it, but it's really pretty sad. And then in India especially, we have probably 50 million monkeys. They love shiny stuff. So they'd be climbing on there and jumping up and down and scratching that stuff. And so this guy in the ministry was telling me, he says, it was really funny. He says, we went down there and these people had covered the solar panel. And he says, you can't cover the solar panel. And the guy says, what do you mean? I have to cover it. Otherwise, the monkeys are going to destroy it. So the problem really was that nobody thought through what happens? And if God knows, if the solar panel breaks, you're going to need a PhD to come and fix it, right? And believe me, there's a lack of PhDs in the villages. And so we looked at that and said, okay, what can we do? So one of my mandates was, it better be able to be repaired in that village, right? So we said, one screwdriver should be able to repair this thing. And if it can't, then you haven't made the right thing yet. And so we got down to that level, and then we made it simpler and simpler and simpler. And the final version so far is this thing. It's all stuck. This in quantity is going to take a couple hundred dollars to make. And the interesting part is, I never thought of it, but when I went to India and I talked about it, they looked at it from the old style view. You know, it's one of those things, if you own your house, it's a huge, huge thing versus renting, right? Old style. And their view was, we now own our own electricity. We don't pay monthly. Monthly, you were renting electricity. Now we own it. And it was a huge thing that, okay, now I just never have a bill. So the amount of, you want to get on? So I'm not going to do it. Go ahead. So as you can see, it's old technology. 100 years old. It could have been done 100 years ago. Those are flywheels, invented late 1900s, right? The rest is just a bicycle with an alternator and a battery. That's it. It looks really simple, but it took a few years to get it this simple. It's amazing how difficult it is to make things something simple. But it's sort of like, I think somebody said about a statue. He says, how do you turn this big piece of marble into a beautiful figure? He says, well, you just chip away everything that's not the figure. Same thing with this. This is what we did. We took away everything that was extraneous at all. And this is how much it creates. So you have your cell phone, you have an iPad, you have a fan, you have a bunch of light bulbs, all of that. So if you pedal for an hour and you store it, now you can have, one of the places we gave it to was a school. And the only thing they had was a chalkboard. They didn't have books. And from that, they went to straight from a chalkboard only to the internet. So they went from nothing to everything, within this. Now, there's a lot of people who are trying to make internet accessible to everyone. Oh, wait a minute. How are you going to do that without electricity? First things first. It's like saying, I'm going to get you great living room furniture. Oh, you don't have a house. Yeah, the house has to come first. You can't. So this is what we've done. Anyway, that's good. So that's one thing. Then we're working on water, which is the next big thing. And so we've got some amazing technology in water as well. Water is going to be something. I like this one better because it's shiny, and so everybody gets it really quick. You can see things light up, things shine. And I unveiled this in India last year in November, did 11 hours of interviews, and everybody from the north to south, the east to west, everybody knew about it. They couldn't believe something like this was possible because most people had electricity only about 3 hours a day. And so if you're to that level, that's what you have. So anyway, that's our main piece. Then we have other things like in water and then farming also. We've come up with something that will change farming for the rural poor completely. It'll take half the water and they will make money for the first time in 20 years. So there's a bunch of stuff going on. I think, these people are my customers. These are the people that I care about. This is probably one of my last speeches. Because I've also found that the high and mighty are not going to help. The rich want legacy or credit or something. Politicians want to just announce things. And we found out that we're going to do this ourselves. And we've come up with a model that's different. So if you look at a nonprofit, the problem is, since nobody has to produce anything, there's not very efficient, right? And then a for-profit model, well, I'm not interested. We have enough money. So we came up with this model, which is zero profit, which is you run it as efficiently as if it's a real business, but then you subsidize the price to the level where you have zero profit. Well, if I can make this at zero profit, I can make unlimited amount. I think that the need in the world that we looked at is probably 150 million units anyway. And so at zero profit, I can make them. If I gave it away, I'd be broke in about 3 to 4 months, which would not be good. So that's pretty much all I've got. I hope this was, if not useful, hopefully some of it was entertaining. Thank you.
Manoj, thank you very much. Thank you very much.
I think there's a Q&A.
I believe there is a Q&A.
Okay.
Boys and girls, Manoj Bhargava. Thank you very much. Now, this is extraordinary. Now, we do have some audience questions, and one of them is, how long will it take for all people to have a health chip?
We're going into production in August, but there's the problem with medical is there's a lot of regulatory everywhere. So in some countries, it'll be faster, or other countries slower. But I'd say in the next couple of years, it should be everywhere.
Thank you. How valuable is data from patients who passed away? How valuable is the data of patients who've passed away? That's an interesting question.
Passed away, I don't quite understand.
Kind of died. Is there data any more valuable of the dead ones?
The value of the data is, look, somebody in our company put it, we're not big data, we're little data. Right? Little data meaning data for the organism. And so what we're doing is collecting all of this data on each person so that the intelligent decisions can be made and proper diagnosis can be made. And that we believe that this company is probably going to be valued in the next 5 years in the 100 billion mark.
And there's one more question I'd like to ask. How do you overcome the fear of the people getting chipped? I would imagine there's a few who are quite scared of getting the chip implanted.
No, these aren't implanted at all. They're actually by an adhesive. They just put it on you and you can peel it off. There's nothing invasive. I don't do anything invasive. That's too scary.
And obviously, being in Europe, you know, there's always the question of, well, what's with Big Brother, you know, good old George Orwell? What would you reply to that question?
I'm sorry.
You know, with George Orwell, the old Big Brother's watching, there's
right.
always an imminent fear.
No, first of all, every country has incredibly strict laws on privacy. So each country, the data will reside in that country. You can't take it out. So those safeguards are already there. But this data can't really be used to do any harm. I don't really know how you're going to harm somebody if you know their heart rate.
That's pretty straightforward. Manoj, and I have one last question from my point of view. Earlier, you may have mentioned that saying ecosystem is a bad thing. Now, obviously, I'm hosting this festival where we have 7 ecosystems. I'm in a quite bad position here. Is it okay if I say ecosystem?
Have at it.
Thank you so
Obviously.
Much. Thank you so much, Manoj Bhargava. Thank you very much, Manoj. Thank you so much.
All right, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Wow.